Today I'm going to talk about machine.
Okay.
Now I'm going to talk about applications of machine learning in online advertising domain. So briefly, here is my outline. Although some of the topics are covered in earlier talks, I think, like it starts with like a need for machine learning and big data in general, and then online advertising industry and some of the challenges in that domain. And then I will be talking about some of the machine learning applications in publishing. So finally, I will be covering some of the challenges aspects in our day.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. So I think by now everyone knows the importance of machine learning. It's like useful for it. Many number of applications, like our day-to-day life, we have spam filtering, clustering, and the simplest application is Google List, which does the clustering internally, the document clustering, so that it can find all the similar news for you. Then you have recognition everywhere now. You have from face to action recognition, all kinds of recognition that are being embedded into various devices. So if you go to e-commerce domain, you have these product recommendations. Any other kind of like in the previous talks people have talked about. So if you go to social networking, you have friend recommendations. So machine learning has become like part of many of the applications that are going right now. So why big data and machine learning in general? So right now, if you see any application, it generates lots of data, and there has been huge many advancements in various, like if you take internet or if you take hard disk or anything, so there are many advancements. So because of which, in recent days, there has been a lot of data that has been collected. So you could take advantage of this data in kind of learning many behaviors in any product. So it can help business in taking the product, coming up with good product ideas or taking any important decisions in terms of coming up with what is the better way of selling the product or coming up with the product design. So it helps. The more data you have, the more signals you have. So you could come up with more confident and accurate models. So in general, if you see, the more data you have, the more like corner points you can collect, and then it could just outperform that complex, even if you build any complex algorithm, but without any data. So if you look at online advertising industry, so as you know, like there are various ways in which online advertising happens. Like it could be in various ways, like search advertising. In the case of search advertising, what happens is that you get the sponsored results. For any query that you fire in any search engine, you get the sponsored results, which says like relevant results to the whatever queries you are doing. So these are a way of income for the search engines. And then if you take display advertising, so display advertising is about any web page content. Along with the web page content, you want to display the advertisements related to that are related to users. So that's that traditional display advertising means. And then you have social advertising in the social networking, which has emerged recently. And then you have different mobile advertising or video advertising. So each of these fields have different kind of problems, and the ways in which the advertisements are shown is different. So due to various data that you get, for example, if you take mobile, you get a lot of parameters that you don't get in the normal desktop. So each of these fields are different in each of them. So what's special about online advertising industry? Because of the problems that it has and the like different challenges that it has, a new field of science has arisen. It's like computation advertising. So in all of this, the central goal is about finding the best match between the three entities, like the user, the advertiser, and the publisher. You want to find the best balance. So everyone has their own goals. You want to find out what is the best match across all these three entities. And it comes at the intersection of various interesting fields like machine learning, you have economics, optimization, distributed systems, and all these fields, I mean, the problems touch all these fields, so it is a very interesting domain. So if you see only the digital advertising technology domain, there are right from the end of advertiser to the publisher. So towards your left hand it's advertiser, then if you're this is the publisher. Between the advertiser and publisher, there are so many companies which perform different roles. So basically, these companies try to work on the side of advertiser. They try to optimize any return on investment for the advertiser. These companies try to work for the publisher. So ultimately, each of them have different roles and each of them are trying to outbid each other. So they, when any advertisement is being shown, so these companies may or may not be directly called, but each of them will have their own goal. Like, for example, in the case of PubMatic, PubMatic is working on the side of publishers, so it falls in this end. So, what are the important metrics that are present in the ad tech? So, usually, then, what metrics usually people care? So, they include impressions. Impressions means what is the total number of times a ad is shown. That's the fundamental metric, so that is what is required. Then you have unique users, which is the total number of distinct users that a advertisement is being shown to. Then you have various ways in which ultimately the advertising cost or the revenue model happens. It could be various ways, like it could be simply based on just how many times the impressions were shown. So usually it is referred as CPM, so that is calculated based on cost per every 1,000 impressions. Then you have click-based cost or action-based. So action-based implies like if I'm showing an advertisement and I would pay you only if that advertisement gives me a conversion of the product, like if the user is buying this product and the revenue. So as I told, in online advertising industry, everyone has their own goals. Each of them is having their own goals and different challenges. Like if you see, in general, advertisers want more return on investment. And if you see demand side partners or any ad networks, they try to optimize clicks, or they could also try to optimize the return on investment. So SSPs, like the ones which work on the side of publishers, they want to try to get more eCPMs. So like this, each of them has their own goals, and sometimes these goals could be complementary to each other. So if you want to do any of the machine learning, before going into the problems, I just would like to give an idea about what kind of data we have. So in general, you have this kind of data, like you will have a user identifier, like the cookie that was mentioned in the earlier talk. You get many of these details from that, the location, browser, what time of the day he is visiting that ad, and the language, and so many other details. Like if you go to the advertiser details, you will have what are all the entities that are involved in displaying that advertisement. What DSP, what advertiser, what is the category and price. So along with this data, there is some external data that is being collected also. Like there could be some third party data providers which could give an idea about the user. So they would be getting that idea based on different ways, like offline data. It could be bank transactions or anything. So that is like an extreme case, but it could be just like a virtual identifier, where first suppose you somehow are having the data from a large retail provider like Target. So you could get this kind of different data points. So before going to further applications in PubMatic, first I will give you an idea about general machine learning applications in ad technology domain. So one of the famous problems is the click prediction. So the goal in general, like for any advertiser, like if they're trying to see that their product is being visited by as many people, so they also want to see that they are landing onto their web page. They just not see the impression ad, but also they want to see make sure that their web page has been visited. So in those cases, they want to try to optimize the clicks. So the problem is that you know that in the history, what kind of impressions have generated clicks and what kind of impressions have not generated the clicks. So this is a classification problem, basically, where you have that data, positive samples and negative samples about the clicks, and you want to generate a model which says that given any impression, whether it has a high probability of click or not. then in the case of search, for search, when a search query is fired, so in order to get the sponsored results, there is an option that happens in the behind. Like, first suppose Google is trying to find out which sponsored search results it has to show. Then in the background, it tries to find out what are all the advertisers which are trying to bid for that keyword. So first suppose two advertisers are trying to bid for the same keyword, then how should they choose the bid such that they can win? And from the case of Google, it's like which advertiser he has to select so that ultimately he can charge the advertiser, because there is also property of whether the ad is going to be clicked on. So there are two problems. One is about selection of the bid from the case of advertisers, and from the case of the search engine perspective, it's about selecting which advertiser. Like, which advertiser will give you the best revenue in terms of the clicks. So that's another problem where learning is kind of useful. And in general, for ad networks or any some of the advertising entities, usually what happens is that in the first visit, the user cares about the advertisement. But as you show the same advertisement again and again, you might not be interested in the advertisement. So the number of times you show the ad is called as a frequency. So you want to find out what is the optimal frequency at which you want to stop showing the advertisement. So for that, you kind of can see the historical data, how, like, what, till what time he's kind of giving the conversion, users are giving conversion for what kind of ads. So this could be useful for kind of finding out by what time I should stop showing this advertisement, so that he can concentrate on showing different advertisements to the user. So another problem is yield optimization. So like I said, there are each different kind of inventories. Inventory implies like the impressions are the kind of characteristics of the impressions. So different characteristics could be useful for different advertisers. Like, so you want to find out what is the optimal match between the right set of impression characteristics and the advertisers, so that you can get high returns. So that's the problem of yield optimization. So for this, you want to allocate your impressions such a way that you find out the best advertiser for every kind of impression attribute set that you have.
Can you give me an example of an impression characteristic?
So like I explained in the previous slide, the data points that we have, like the browser, the geolocation. And so basically on the fly, first suppose you get a request saying that, okay, this user has visited this web page. Now you want to find out what is the best advertisement that I want to show. And can I show the other advertisement now? You have multiple advertisements, you want to select the best one so that your overall yield can be maximized. Basically, you have, let's say, 1,000 impressions and you have 5 advertisements. Now, how you want to allocate these impressions in such a way that we can get the best revenue? So that's kind of optimization problem. Another problem is like the user segmentation problem. So here, like in online domain, like for this advertising, you track the users by looking at the cookie, which gives a virtual identity. So that's the user ID. So now from this virtual ID, you want to get a profile of what he is, like what are the interests of this user, so that advertisers can target the users properly. Like, first, so basically for every user, you want to find out what audience segment. So audience segment could be like whether he's a rich person or a poor person, or whether he's say interested in kind of sports or movies. So these kind of interests, you want to somehow get a profile of the audience, so that proper advertisers could be targeted to the proper audience. So that's another problem which involves kind of tracking the users from various websites, and then you want to find out it's kind of clustering, saying that, okay, this user is visiting this website, this website, this website, and all these websites are belonging to the movie sector, so that are the category. So that means that his interests include movies. So that's user segmentation problem. And there is, like, you also have this problem of forecasting, because in general, first suppose you are planning to, if I'm a publisher, say I'm Yahoo, I want to make sure that for the next year event, the Super Bowl event, I want to make sure that all my inventory is being sold, so that now itself I can make the deals beforehand and then I can plan well. For that purpose, you need to find out what is the amount of regression that I'm going to expect. So you have the historical data points, like over the past year's data, and now you want to find out how many impressions you are going to get in the next event. So these are the kind of problems that you deal in the online advertising industry. So now I'll talk specifically about PubMatic, like what PubMatic does and what are the kind of problems. I give some examples on what PubMatic does. So like I said, PubMatic works on the publisher side. That is, we try to maximize the revenue for the publishers. Or it could be certain other goals also, like you want to fill as many impressions as possible with any advertisement, but you don't want to lose any impression without showing an ad. So there are many goals for the publisher. Each of them could be different, and we try to optimize these goals. So for this purpose, what we do is we are integrated with many demand sources, that is like advertiser entities, which kind of provide that, which work on the side of the advertisers. So they are the providers for advertisements. So we conduct auction across all these demand sources. So for some of them, which we get the bids on the fly, like what is the value of these impression characteristics on the fly in real time. So that is called as real time bidding in online advertising. So that is usually being done by demand side partners. What they do is, whenever impression request comes, we get the bids from all the demand side partners saying that, okay, for this impression characteristic, I'm going to bid this value. And now we try to find out the max of all these and then just give the best advertiser who is paying the highest. So in the case of ad networks, which are like the older technology stack, so they don't do anything in real time. They kind of provide us the historical aggregates of like values of revenue or the impressions. Like for example, in the last 2 days you have got this much amount of money, but they don't provide you exactly like if the impressions are coming from India and if they are coming specifically from Pune, how much is it valued. So those kind of details are not available. In that cases, if you want to do a fair auction, then you want to predict how much is going to pay based on the historical data. So if you see pictographically, this is how it looks like. Basically, it's an example. So let's say these are like four channels in which the auction happens. You have some direct deals with the advertisers. There are agency trading desks which are also bidding. And then there is ad networks, which is it for which we don't have a price available. And then you have demand side platform for which you have the live auction with live bids. So what PubMatic does is to kind of find the best advertiser which can give the best price. So like I told you, in the case of ad networks, we don't have any price. So we need to predict the price for every impression. So for that purpose, we have developed something called as ad price prediction engine. So the goal, like I said, is to maximize the revenue for the publisher. Because we don't have the granular data, I mean, this is required. Like I said in previous example, you don't have for every impression what is the price that needs to be paid. So like we have historical aggregates of the impression delivered and prices paid. And now you want to find out how much each characteristic would give you so that you can optimize the revenue. So one of the ways in which this was solved by like using the user frequency approach. So we know that over each frequency, generally ad networks pay us lesser amount. As the frequency increases, the amount of incipient decreases. Like you will have it in the first frequency, they pay you higher, and as in the second frequency, they pay you lesser. And as the frequency increases, the incipient might drop. And at certain cap, they will not pay you at all. That means that they are not interested in showing any advertisement. So the problem looks like this. Like you have the historical aggregates. So this is what was reported, and you have the historical impressions. Now what is unknown is this ECPM I for every frequency. So this is the formulation. You have a equation and you have some constraints. So ECPM is like the cost for every 1000 impressions. That's CPM, that is cost per million, like I explained in this. So it's the way how the advertiser wants to pay the publisher.
And the frequency part?
Frequency is like what is the number of times the user has visited certain advertisement alone. So that's the user feedback. So this can be solved by any optimization solver or some genetic algorithms for getting the solution of these reasons.
Yes.
So this is one of the.
Yes. So there are some paid features. Keep your advertisement and they're paid for that. So they are not genuine visitors. But
so those, that is altogether a different problem. That's about fraud detection, I think, what you're talking about.
This doesn't account for that.
So that's altogether a different problem which is solved in a different manner. So this is different. So here you are trying to find out the optimal price for every impression capture. So those techniques could be used and you could filter up those data where you find out that there is an abnormal
pattern.
So in this case there are no clicks involved, it's just based on the impressions. This is based on only CPM. If you are paying for CPC basis, then you care about clicks. So another problem that we kind of try to solve is finding out what are the impression characteristics which have higher demand, that is what is cared most by advertisers. Like, and then there could be a lot of actions that can be taken by finding out this. Whether if certain impression characteristics are very high valued or low valued. Or suppose you know that certain characteristics are very high, then you can try and get more such kind of impressions on your platform and then you can get more revenue. Another way is that you could also say that, okay, this kind of inventory is not at all giving me any revenue, so I will stop taking that inventory and then I can save my infrastructure. So these kind of business decisions can be taken by kind of getting these kind of predictions. So again, for this problem also, you have the historical data saying what kind of impression was paid by what advertiser, how much is it. So if you want to find out this, whether it is high value or low value, you can use this data and then probably some classification algorithm, simple classification algorithm. You can start with decision tree algorithms probably. You can find out, like, you can get a tree which kind of says what kind of impressions are having high value, what kind of impressions can be classified into low value. And this can result in a kind of tree structure which could be converted into rules. So having this in terms of rules is advantageous because it could be easily kind of limitable. That's one simplest advantage because you're dealing with online advertising where you want to make the decisions very fastly because it's all in milliseconds. You want to do this in a millisecond, so it's very important. So, for example, like, as I said, so it's an example of decision tree, how it looks like. Basically, you have at every node, you kind of make a decision whether this attribute belongs to this kind of node or not, and then you kind of take a decision. For example, this path, if all together it has this kind of combination of attributes, it says that this is a high value impression. And other kind of impressions are not high value. So another problem that we have is about detecting the outliers. So because it's an online business and we have a lot of data flowing on in a real time, and if something goes wrong or if there is any drop in the revenue or drop in impressions because of some reason, if there is some problem somewhere, you want to take action so that the loss that is incurred is as less as possible. So for that purpose, you want to kind of find out if there is any abnormal data point in your data stream or not. So that can be mapped to the traditional anomaly detection problem where you have historical continuous stream of data that is flowing. For example, you have the revenue or like the win rate, or if you are having a Hadoop cluster where you want to find out if something is wrong with the Hadoop cluster metrics, then you could use these kind of techniques to find out the anomalies in the, and then you can just take the action so that the any revenue loss that you have can be decreased. So for this purpose, you could use like simple statistic approaches, like you can just have this based on Gaussian, like you can calculate the mean and sigma, then you can just have based on like mean plus or minus 2 sigma, and then just see if it is falling out of that range. And that you can see, like, based on the recent trends.
I have a question, but you come at a point where you could stop and I will ask the question.
Yeah.
You're telling me there's a set of techniques, okay? A set of processes, equations that you're using, that's what is used in the industry, and you process someone's data. Okay? Now the point of machine learning is that you're gonna be able to use the machine to learn to be more efficient or better.
Yes.
Right? So I'm using all these algorithms and statistical methods if it doesn't translate into better business. Right? So it has to be a loop.
Yes.
Somewhere this loop has to close. Now we're talking about a whole set of techniques here. This, that, this, eliminating bad data, processing data better, whatever you have. So you at some point want to cover that, where you're going to tell us how, by using machine learning, ad tech and your business got better. Right? Yes, I know that you use better algorithms, better processing, more protocols, more signals, you get better. That's good. But the point of machine learning is, it's a superior approach because you can use the feedback into the system, right? So that's a critical point we would like to know.
Yeah, so I don't know how you understood. So basically for this kind of, like you know from the historical data, for example in this case, you know what historically, you have seen that these kind of operations are giving me good revenue, these are not giving me good revenue. So you can stop taking, for example, you decide saying that, okay, these kind of operations are causing a problem to the business. They are eating too much of my infrastructure cost, but not resulting in any revenue. So there you are kind of helping the business in kind of improving by learning from the data. What patterns are the ones which are causing, giving you the good revenue, and what are not giving you the good revenue?
So you're saying if I apply more algorithms, I will have better business.
Yes.
That's what you're saying. Which means that I just have to pump this through more algorithms, more filtering, and I'll get cleaner, better data. Is that what it is?
Yes, up to a certain extent, yes. That's what it's trying to do, right? It's trying to look at the data and then find out what is the best decision that needs to be taken.
So it's the AI aspect where there's a feedback. Right?
Because it's not all the cases you have a feedback. For example, in the previous, so even in this case of this tree, for suppose you train it on the historical data and then you validate your approach on new data set. Then you kind of see whether it is performing well or not. If it is not performing well, then you kind of modify your parameters. So you kind of take a signal and then use that in your previous modeling. So over time you can improve your model also, right? In the first time you can't get a best model. Then you kind of see how your model is performing over time. Then it kind of tries to adapt to the data. Whatever latest data you have, and it kind of tries to adapt to that data, it gets the new model training parameters, and then you can get better results.
So, you want to cover the adaptation part, because the adaptation part is what the learning happens.
No, not specifically. I'm then just covering this. So, this is like one example where like anomaly detection could be useful. For suppose you find that there is a sudden dip in the revenue data, you want to find this kind of anomalies, then you could kind of use these techniques and then inform the corresponding team so that you can take action and save money to the business. So some of the challenges that we have is that there are various kind of impressions and there are different ways in which different advertisers are bidding. There are so many mixed signals. So sometimes one method might not be working for all kind of data or all kind of advertisers or publishers. So you might have to deal with different types in a different manner, trying to fit the best models for each of them separately. So that becomes very challenging because the number of publishers and advertisers that you're working and the combinations that you work can increase over time, and then you kind of have to find out the best way to address this. And then whatever model that you build sometimes might not work well all the time. That is because of the too much volatility in the data. Suppose if you have a forecasting problem, like in the previous example where you have the Nifty prediction, you had too much noise in the data. So if the same kind of pattern exists here, sometimes you will not be able to do any good prediction. So if the data becomes too volatile, then it becomes difficult in terms of fine-tuning the parameters or coming up with new methods. And as we deal with very large scale data, we usually work with big data technologies, and then we kind of run all our algorithms on mostly on big data platform. If suppose they are fitting in the memory, then you could use it on standalone machines, but if you want to kind of use more data, then probably you depend on big data. But at least for getting the aggregated or the sampling data, you still need to depend on these big data technologies. Coming to the implementation part, like I said, we usually either use the aggregated data or like we kind of sample the data so as to fit the data on your local machine or any desktop machine. If there are cases where you could not probably just do by sampling because you might not cover all the cases, then probably you might have to run it on the complete data. So there, using the distributed technologies is very helpful. So some of the tools that we use are HBase, and we use R and Vega, and there are many other technologies that are available, like these are upcoming but they are still in exploratory. Like you have Spark based methodology, which is like the MLLib is the library which is based on this Apache Spark. We haven't explored it, but I think that's one of the good directions in future. And then if you want to use R on distributed, again, you could also, there is one R Hadoop. Again, these are all like in the ecosystem, although we haven't really tried out much, but this could be probably useful if you're dealing with the distributed problems.
Can you talk about R
and R? So it's basically
distributed R is a driver for connecting to Hadoop.
So what it tries to do is, it kind of, suppose you have, it tries to divide your task into Hadoop framework and then get the result to you in a single machine. So it internally divides the task.
Hadoop works on the map produced by that.
Yes.
R may not necessarily work on R is mostly statistical.
Yeah, yeah. So it tries to divide, for some of the algorithms, it tries to divide your problem into distributed manner and then tries to execute each of these tasks in separate machines and then tries to aggregate the final result. Wherever it is applicable, that works there. Any other questions?
In what context and use cases you saw by using Mongo, R and Vector? Do you do it differently for different use cases?
Yeah, so I mean, also it was kind of evolutionary in nature. Sometimes, yeah, use case dependent also. Like if you want to prototype or if you want to see what algorithm works best, based on the algorithm evaluation. For example, Mohot has this frequent pattern growth algorithm. If you want to apply on large scale data, you want to find out what are the kind of attributes that are occurring together. So that could be useful. Or if you're doing the distributed k-means clustering, so Mohot has good implementation there. And for R, it is like if you want to do any simple prototyping where you have this data set which can fit in your machine, then you could do those experiments.
Out of this three, which one you call generally more?
No, it's use case. I can't do this. So it's like if you're going for big data, still no library is completely having all the features. Like Vega, if you see there are so many features in it, but still it can't run in a distributed manner. And R, you can prototype, again it's not distributed. But Mohot, it has distributed, but it still doesn't cover all the algorithms. So each has its own pros and cons. It doesn't have vast coverage of algorithms, and also it's not like completely adopted by, it's still in early stages. You can't say that it is completely has as good capability or algorithms that are built in other, like other vehicles. Support wise also, although it's still ongoing, like they are bringing the support for Spark, etc.
Are there recommendations where these could be suitable, where these technologies could be suitable, like R versus Vega?
So basically, if it is simple, if you want to do the prototyping, R is a good point to start. R or Python. Python has this scikit library, so you can start with that for prototyping purposes, for learning purposes.
Can you go
back to the
technology? Yeah.
Technology is last one.
Which one?
The last one.
Yeah.
Here you don't seem to be using something like a weird platform or something.
Yeah, so those are all still under kind of developments or daily machines.
Yes,
we are.
Well, these most of them,
yes, yes. So this is all like over time we have evolved. Like I said, so it's all evolutionary. Okay. Initially we started with lesser data. As the data grows, now it's a test stage where you want to take patients in real time. So for that, yes, Kong and other real time training is going to work on that.
What about the visualization? Nice solid day.
So visualization, I think if you really interested, probably D3.js is one good framework, I think. So that's, I would recommend.
Hello.
Yep. Thanks to see you.